Risk Management Committee, the last one of this year. Can I just welcome our new committee clerk, Patrick Sebastian, on the end here. Welcome, Patrick.
Thank you, Chair.
Item one, code of conduct. I've got any declarations of interest. Item 2 minutes. Can we agree to... Item 3, officer decision notice permitted under the council's contract procedure rules, pages 11 to 16.
Yes, Chair. This is a report from the council's regulatory committee. This is probably the first time it's happened, to be honest. The contract procedure rules will also change you, whereby the officer decision notices should be reported annually to committee. So this is the first one of a series of regular reports. This one brings one part of the contract procedure records, the contract register held at the centre, has details of contract variations, contract extensions. That's agreed to bring to the committee every year and update those contracts which have been extended or varied and agreed with the delegated authority. The authorities were set out under the revised contract procedure rules, which were agreed in December 2013. And basically, this report provides an appendix which details all those that have been accepted during the current financial year. Just to highlight the main ones in there, perhaps the public health extension to the contract, which came to about 7.9 million, which was subsequently reported to Cabinet by the Director of Public Health in January this year. And there were some extensions there around the IT, about the engagement. IT kit. This is part of the progression the implementation to go on RGP. And a lot of the other ways in there is around school meals. So it's part of the school meal service. Those are part of the three big items in the appendix. Other than that, the report shows for noting, I'll have to take any questions.
Thanks, Tom. Any questions? Stuart.
First, maybe to the extensions that are when we get to the description, it doesn't really give much in the way of detail about why it was felt an extension was appropriate. The description just says we've extended. I wouldn't be on the extension list if it was any other. I mean, in your fairness, the waivers, there's a lot more detail in the waivers, explains why they're. Why they were felt necessary. It was very little in the way of why the extension was felt necessary. For example, and you know, I know we had this discussion last time where I was asking, you know, when it comes to extension, do we end up in a position where we're going to extend, you know? And when I read the one on what was it, business travel, which related to a contract with Redfair, and then later on when I was reading through the agenda, I saw Redfair and referred to it again in the auditor's reports. So we have an audit report from October 2014, where internal audit makes the comment. Responsibility for the management of the Redfair travel contract has not been established nor signed to nominated officers to lead on strategic issues, especially where we tell you the contract is achieved in the next 12 months. That was the conclusion was reached in October 14. The extension was made in April 14. So if that was the conclusion in October, that it wasn't properly assigned, potentially not being properly managed, that was certainly the case in April, wasn't it? So it strikes me, reading those two things, that falls into exactly the concern that I raised last meeting, that we end up with contracts that reach the end of their life, say within a month at the end of their life, and we end up in a panicky situation where we have to extend. It might just be bad luck, if you like, on the part of officers that they report this to us in one way, and then it's appeared on the auditor's update. and the fact that I read it on it long ago, it was still in there. That's in my mind. So it starts to concern me how many more of the extensions fell into the same category that we seem to have in the auditor's reports, that the contract wasn't actually being monitored in time for it to be properly tendered. Now, and taking the public health out, I appreciate that skews the figures. You know, I mean, there's allowably £7 million worth of contract extensions here. I appreciate 7.9 of that is all down to the public health one, which was reported to the cabinet. But that still leaves another £4 million worth of extensions that where contracts are simply being extended for what reason we're not entirely clear, and none of that has been tested against the market. You know, I just wondered what comments obviously might have on that in general, or on the left-hand issues specifically.
In terms of all requests that go for extensions or waivers, there is more detailed documentation behind it. This is just a summary that's held on the database. In terms of some of the waivers, we've looked around the patient form box, I think it's quite clear definitions for why they've been extended. For example, one doesn't appear there has been one issue, where there have been issues with that contract, it was found ahead of the fraud in the extension. I think in the interim, because we decided to extend the contract, whilst it's sorting out who was formally managing the contract responsible for taking it forward. So, was the contract in place? Did you go out and do a further contract? But something you'll have to go through and identify what the contract was. At that stage, it was decided to extend it for a further period while the issues were sorted out. Then pick up on the comments from the audit as to how to take that
away. I think my point, if I may, is that, okay, the red flags have been picked up by the audit, but what about the domestic furniture contract? What about the remodeling of the working world? I mean, I don't know, frankly, do I, whether the same situation is true of more of these projects, as has now been found to be true of the red flag one. And that was the concern that I raised last time, and you know, which, in a sense, I know this is going to go on more possibly a more regular, but yearly events. But this is the information that actually we asked for at the last meeting in any case, so that we could get a bit on why we're extending contracts, what the reasoning behind it is, and I'm not sure that's quite what we've got in front of us. If that's how the spreadsheet comes off the computer, then that's how it comes off the computer, that's fine. But maybe for the future, we need to see exactly why the contract was extended. Do we take it then that if we've had the additional information on all of the contracts, the one under business track model would have said we just missed the opportunity to re-tender it, and we're actually faced with extending it, because we have no other choice, or how many of the others fall into that category. That's what I can't get a grip on, just looking at this appendix.
If it helps members, there's 9 contracts there. I'll go back and provide a list of members as to reasons, particular reasons for the extensions for those 9 particular contracts that would help. It is all contained on the documentation, because everybody put a request through it. It's a 3 to 4 side of document. These are just an extract of the key items that are put on the database. There is a lot more information behind it. Because the things that are checked are, is it still value for money? Is the price reasonable going forward? Have we followed the right procedures? And that will extend, there is explanation on there for each of those as to why it has been extended. It should have been running. I apologise for that. I can circulate a list of the reasons why to members of that.
I think
I'm sure David has David that's what David wants to
do. Yeah, you can go. Excuse me. I want to thank Tom because I think he took a
Yeah, thank you.
Mine is similar, really. It refers to what Stuart said and to what Tom's already said. On that question of actuarial, which is the one underneath the public health one, I'm having the father of them. She's thinking actually the Royal Insurance Company, actually. And I'm just trying to get my head around why we have to pay them £750,000 more than originally anticipated for what for something which one would have thought would have been done and dusted and, you know, unnecessary. Wouldn't it be in need of having an extension to it? Can you just briefly explain that, Tom?
I'm not aware of the specifics on that one, but it looks like it's a pension from contract with the services that are bought in annually, and that was extended for a further year.
So the 750,000 is just, it's not an addition to what was done previously, it's just this particular contract has been extended for a year, and that's all it is, and we budgeted for that, presumably. Right, okay, I understand that now. I think, as the others have said, a little bit more detail, I was writing a 45-page report, a little bit more detail as the reason why these are done, which background, I think would be helpful to all of us. Thanks, Jim.
That's good. Paul?
Thanks, Chair. I mean, three of these items are extensions of pension fund, and they were all discussed in great detail at our last committee meeting. So, for those three, including the actuarial, I'm personally very familiar with the reasons as to why that was all extended. To me, this is just a summary of I'm not aware of what's going on with other departments and other committees, but to me, it just brings everything together. But pension fund items, which is three, they have been discussed and presented in great detail. Like this is just bringing it all together, isn't it?
Apologies, I missed that, but I think.
So these, so as I say, the three pensions have all been to committee and been discussed in great detail.
I think if you look at they've gone to the pensions committee.
Right.
We are now.
So this is just a summary of pensions.
As decisions have been made, they're within our remit, which has been reported to us as such through here, but we don't have to support background noise which tells us what the pension committee has done and how it's done. This is that's probably more in line with that.
I assume that report to pension committee is submitted because all of these decisions are officer decisions.
Yeah.
And it brings all of the officer decisions together for proper board and scrutiny. But I appreciate what you're saying. And there was one there, obviously, to cabinet, which again, presumably, was a noting item. But again, it's how it comes off the spreadsheet, isn't it? So rather than filter it for, well, we told pension for what we and what we told cabinet, we don't need to tell anybody else. That's probably fine. Can I just ask one more question where the numbers don't quite help? There's one here for Spirit to IT call off. Something to do with IT. The commentary describes IT requirements for sum of 3 million and the value is listed as 4 million. So it wasn't entirely clear whether the value was 3 or 4 million for that. There's a couple of others which I assume are for 2 years, so the total value is given as twice the annual value, but again, it doesn't entirely make it clear that it's for 2 years. I'm only assuming that. For example, the one below it from printing talks about 250k per annum, where the value is given as half a million, so I assume it's a 2-year extension. But I'm not clear on the difference between 3 and 4 million.
Yeah, that's
all. Yeah.
Don't know how to look at that much, but it needs to be out and see.
Yes, and that's just a matter of the interest, really. The way, in fact, it's the first of the waves of the airlines and spirits. Can't believe the captain gets through all that. Where's the rest of it?
Well, I don't see any of it, John.
It's offices.
It's cost 100,000 pounds again, put on anyways. I don't know what period that covers. 3 year contract, 2 year, whatever. I just wondered, who is supplied with this? Why have I been missing out?
Do you think Wise and Spirits put the sports centre to the
comes out of the 100,000. Seems odd. It didn't have to go this far.
Yeah, I think that's probably a good thing.
Reported. I have actually read that whole document, so I don't know what I must be. But
one thing I haven't picked up is how we deal with external risks, like decisions made by the licensing committee or decisions made by the planning department. Do we assess those risks in any way, in the way that they might cause third parties to challenge the council in the way they've undertaken assessment of either planning or licensing decisions? I can't see a reference to that or any mechanism by which we can check or we can cover for identifying risks that might be associated with those two sort of quasi-judicial activities. Do you know where that might be reported, or is it covered, and have I just missed it?
There is reference to that within the corporate district about external decisions and whether external bodies within the corporate district as well. Not within that particular section, it is within the corporate district.
So it's not something that we, it's not something that we'd actually mention or cover in here, because it's obviously a concern to us, because having been on the planning committee for 15 years, we do make some decisions which cause problems on occasion, and I just wonder how we deal, how we deal with those particular issues, and with licensing issues, where we have maybe given somebody a license and it proves to be a mistake. I don't know how it's dealt with, that's all I'm
saying.
Highlighted the 2-4, Councillor steps on it. Important for what we view is due probably in April, May time. That'll be important to this committee in June. At the same time, we refresh the corporate risk register for sort of departmental directors and service plans being updated.
In terms of ensuring that we've got the appropriate mechanisms in place in terms of data management, I can assure members that we will have it in place by December 2015. The reason that it is extended to that is because in terms of the data centres, that will require actually physical moves of the equipment. So we want to make sure that we do that in a managed way rather than put something in place that is undeliverable, given that we have a number of options we're looking at, being that in existing buildings that we own as a council as part of our estate, or actually with partners. So whatever comes of that, we will actually be physically moving some of our equipment. So it will be in this calendar year, and that's why we've kept it as tight as that. But it is monitored. We have an action plan framework to deliver that. In terms of the specific issue that Council Abbey relates to, that was actually a third party host of that particular information. It wasn't DWP and it wasn't Council who did that activity. It certainly was an unfortunate incident. I can confirm that officers were actively engaged and involved with it. We supported our One Stop Shop staff down here. It was an unfortunate error, as I say, held by a third party. Send a text message to all of those people who had been invited to that. But something that we need to review as part of our management with third party agencies, but very good clarify, it wasn't our systems that were hacked, nor was it EW.
Well, thank you, Governor, for that response. I think it's very common to see that we're actually in charge of the road, it's very easy to get involved. take for you, set up the loan account for the year, which is set up section 2.2 onwards. Sets up the work, as I say, when member involvement is. I think it's what we're going to do with the outcome of some of those decisions that have been progressed through the year. It's basically in two areas. One around the list of finance, which is the insurance contracts, and the other around the list of management strategies, the part of the thing with the management policy and how we take that forward. On the section 2.3.1, there's an issue last time about the litigation spending, which is going to extend. One or two members asked questions about the reasons behind that. Paper there says that's one of the reasons why the contract was extended. Along with the work now, we're assessing the tenders that we've received now about to make a little short. In terms of the rest of it, I don't think there's anything else to note. At this stage, the report itself is noted. What?
No, it's fine. It
could be noted that I'd like to congratulate the particular arm of our organisation.
Chris is going to take you through the update report at 7. I'll take you through the what is it I described as the intellect audit plan, the external audit plan at 8, and then Fiona and Blackshear will take you through the pensions audit plan. And thanks for your agreement changing the order on that, so appreciate it. Thanks, Chris.
Thanks, Chair. I'll take you through the audit committee progress report in a familiar format and prepared in early March 2015. It also includes this time a brief annual report to members setting out the results from our certification of your grant claims and returns that's done under the Audit Commission certification regime, and that's an annual requirement. So I can refer you to page 5113, where we set out the main elements of our audit programme. I take into each of the left-hand column items in turn. As what was just mentioned, the 2014-15 audit plan is the next item on our agenda, so I'll leave that to Robin. We then set out our interim accounts audit, and the updated position is again reflected in the audit plan. Briefly, we've completed the majority of our interim work, and our interim testing is nearly complete. I'll let Robin take you through the findings from that. 2014 final accounts audit indicators yet to be started, but a lot of work has already taken place. We meet regularly with Tom and his team to discuss both national and local issues, to share with you best practice and accounting guidance, and that includes a national issue that is reflected in this report about accounting for schools. Pleased to note that the authority are making good progress in the run-up to that. Over the page is the value for money conclusion, a similar picture, even though there's no commentary there. We've held meetings with senior officers, both Joe and Tom, to commence that review. And surprisingly, the key focus of our work will be on looking at your future year savings and budget plans and the MTFS. And we'll reflect back to you any findings to do with the year. And we confirm finally under that section that we have undertaken and completed the certification of a teacher's pension return for you, which is actually dead now outside of the Audit Commission regime and is not included in the report or touch upon. Pages 115 to 121, again, of a familiar format, include recent grant auditing reports. Set up on page 115 is a recent governance report, electronic links to that, should members want to access it, but as we stress, hard copies are available if those were required. The following pages cover local government issues that are topical and emerging accounting and audit issues. As I mentioned, the position in respect of how to account for schools going forward, where there are changes to the way that they are, different types of schools are reflected or not reflected on the council's balance sheet. Towards the back of the report, I just like to draw your attention to beginning on page 122 is the certification report for the council. We are required to certify claims and returns submitted by yourselves, covered by the Audit Commission regime. After many changes, that's now down to a sum total of one in the housing benefit subsidy claim. We set out there that this claim has been subject to qualification for several years and was again subject to qualification in 2013-14. What I want to reiterate is that that is not an unusual position. This is quite a high, complicated claim in terms of the volume of transactions, the complexity of the guidance that has to be interpreted. So most councils that I have experience and knowledge of do have some form of qualification. On page 123, we set out in summary form the main issues, and again, those aren't untypical given the volume of correspondence that you have to deal with. And we finally confirmed there that the audit fee for that work was reduced from that anticipated to a level of £33,000 due to changes in the regulatory regime reflected in the work required. So I didn't propose to say anything more than that. I'm happy to take any questions, should there be any.
Thanks, Chris. Any questions? Thanks, Chris. Could you say the next problem?
Thanks, Chair. Happy to, pleased to introduce to you our audit plan for 2014-15, as Chris has already trailed. As I said earlier, this is the external audit plan. Clearly, if the committee is happy with it, the report, I'm happy to focus the external audit plan. If not, I'm happy to say it's the internal. So we'll see where we get to in terms of that. Just three things I'll do with the plan, if I may. Just briefly revisit and remind the committee what the plan is, what it's trying to achieve, what its purpose is. Then I'll pick out some key messages from the plan around just the work that we do with you. And then finally, just be clear about what I'm asking the committee to do tonight in terms of the plan. Obviously, happy to take any questions. So, we require as your auditors to undertake an audit of the council. And the plan, the purpose of the plan is to set up an understanding of the risks that we think that we face in terms of doing that audit, and then the work we'll do to address those risks. It's part of our ongoing communication with you, which we largely do through reports to this committee, which I know Chris and my predecessor, Mike Thomas, have done with you over a period of time. So in terms of the second thing, just picking out some key issues, well, a big part of the work we do is to support the opinion we give on your financial statements and the detailed report maps we'll bring through to you in September. The report sets out the risk that we considered in terms of that work on the financial statements. Just to be clear, the risks set out there are the standard risks that we present for any local government audit. Those are very briefly looking at issues around operating expenditure, employee remuneration or salaries and wages if you like, and welfare benefits, which is housing benefits, those like that Chris has just referred to. As Chris said, we've completed the majority of our interim work in terms of looking at those systems and controls. Please inform the committee not had any material issues or any worries that we have, that accounts 1% a materially correct position. So clearly now we'll go on once the accounts prepared and presented. We'll do the detailed work on that over the summer and bring a detailed report back to you in September. The other part of the plan also looks at the work we do on the value for money conclusion. We've had previous discussions with you about the sort of improvement journey the council has been on over the last couple of years. Pleased to put on record our congratulations to the council for its award of most improved council at the LGC Awards last week. In terms of our work on that, clearly our work will just be continuing to track the progress that you're making on that improvement journey, particularly around some of the issues around governance and procurement, some of the challenges that all councils face around the financial position over the next couple of years, and in particular looking at how that sort of medium-term financial plan is being updated to address that. So that's what our work will focus on there. Finally, just in terms of the key issues on the plan, the fee for the audit is set out at page 140. So that fee for the audit for the main audit is £213,000. So that fee is consistent with the previous year. That's currently the fee which is currently set by the Audit Commission in terms of the audit of the council. So finally, just in terms of what I'm asking you to do, I'm asking you to sort of note the report, note the work that we plan to do, note that we'll continue to engage with officers around that work, and that we will continue to look to provide you with an efficient and timely audit, as well as continue to engage with you on that improvement journey you've been on. So I hope that's helpful just in terms of the audit plan. And is there any questions?
Well, yeah, just
thank you for that report. I'm very interested in the reading, but it raised a concern. Okay. Under table 131, develop another requirement. Remove the dates and what and probably you can sort of ask council officers what the significance around moving that to move it into. And then from June, when it's tailing, but you know, council changing elections and so forth. And then moving from a September to a July, it's moving into the holiday period. What's the rationale? I know it's not your decision. I wonder what the rationale and what impact. I know every year we tend to struggle with the September date, so how are we going to cope with the July date that's moved 2 months earlier? And then the gap between June and July, July is very tight again. So we're probably going to try to what they've been pointed on. And what you consider the impact would be on that. It would probably very much be resource-driven.
I'm happy to sort of start to address that question. I'm sure officers want to come in as well. I think in terms of what's driving it, clearly this is a government decision, a government policy. I think it reflects their view that best practice with any organisation is to seek to try and close the accounts and get our financial reporting out of the way as quickly as possible. And I think one of the challenges they have is that there are certain parts of the public sector, particularly perhaps in the health side, where they're able to achieve that on a more quick close down. So, it is challenging. Some councils are able to achieve that, and that clearly does bring resource requirements, it brings a real focus around it, and it does mean people have to realise holidays, and undoubtedly that is true. But I mean, that would be my initial response. Happy to pass that over as well.
Yeah, to answer that, yeah, it does bring a further challenge. Some authorities can't close their accounts by April and have the audit done by the end of May. That takes the extreme rather than the law. I think moving forward, May, we've got a year or so to deal with that. What it would mean is probably making greater use of estimates, plus doing more work through the year. So again, all the work we're doing around the financial marketing of the year, bringing that forward so we're in the best position. So when we reach the end of March, how do we then sort of use April more productively? Because in the past we've had areas where you keep paying invoices during April, so you cut off the year effectively at the 30th of April. So effectively we've lost the month. So it's how we bring that forward. We've made steps over the last 3 to 4 years to bring that forward a couple of weeks. So we're now sort of cut off the cares early in April. It's again, can we take that further forward? Yes, there is a results issue, but in a way it focuses the attention. Perhaps during April and May the focus should be on the year and the accounts, and perhaps that should be. I don't say to the detriment of all the things, but I think it will precedence around those other things about being concerned. In terms of the audit, the implication on the audit as well, that deadline being brought forward means yes, a lot of the work will be done for potentially a holiday period, but it occurs now, a lot of the work occurs now during July and August, and we bring that forward a month or so. It'll be a challenge, but it's one I'm sure we can write.
Okay,
now.
Okay.
Okay, thanks for that report.
Yeah.
changes and challenges which pension funds are having to face at the moment. As I'm sure you're aware, we are discussing with the officers how the council is responding to those and sharing what we can find in terms of what we're finding elsewhere to help with that agenda. And our report, which I think is mentioned in our update report, Stronger Futures, is trying to pull together some of the practices around governing pension funds and also trying to support pension funds in bringing in new changes as well. We then talk about the specific risks that we've identified for the fund, and just to clarify for members that those are the inherent risks for a fund of this size and its complexity. There aren't any unique or particularly local risks in there. We are currently on with the interim work, but at this point there are no issues that we need to report to you, and obviously we will update you at the end of the audit as well. And we have been working with Mark's team in terms of the work that they're doing on pension funds, so to try and take as much advantage of that work as we can. And finally, just to mention, on page 12 is the scale fee for the audit, which is unchanged from the fee letter that we received earlier in the year. But in addition to the scale fee, there's a small fee of £2,180, which is similar to previous years, well, it's the same as previous years, for providing insurance to other auditors for the estimates that are provided by the actuary to all the underlying employers of the fund. So happy to take any questions.
Just a very quick one, thank you, Jo. Very quick one, actually. On page 8, the top item there, you've got investment value, level 2 investment valuation is incorrect, is being a risk. Is that a regular thing where people overstate them and therefore you base your policies on incorrect information? Is that something that happens regularly?
No, this is more of an inherent risk, and it's a bit of shorthand, and apologies for that, I should have explained what we mean by level 2 investments.
Well, that's good.
Level 2 investments are the sort of investments that you have which aren't quoted on an active market, but for which there is market data available. So it tends to be pooled investment vehicles and your property portfolio. So for those sorts of investments, the potential for error in the valuation is greater, because it's not simply a case of taking a value off the stock market and applying it to the unit. So it's a little bit more complex. So slightly.
So what you're doing is, I'm trying to impress you, what you're relying on is the professionality of the person who's undertaking the valuation.
Yes.
So
with your property portfolio, it's a case of looking at what your value has done and making sure they're appropriate.
How do you try to minimise that risk? I mean, do you go to people who are,
Well, our first question
glass
is...
Glass half empty, as opposed to glass half
full. Our first question is, how do you minimise that risk? And again, I suppose the property investments is a good example. So you have an external valuer who comes in and values that portfolio.
I'm just thinking how much it varies over time. The value will vary easily over time because of the short-term decision made by government or somebody else. And yet you're basing an awful lot of your returns on those decisions being correct.
Yes.
And they are at risk of being more incorrect than all the other things, don't they?
Yes, they are, and it's the inherent nature. And in fact, on the previous page, which talks about level 3 investments, yes, which are even more subjective, which are more like sort of private equity investments, where there is no real market data, and it is simply, it is a valuation by the underlying should something horrendous happen in the market.
Okay, thank you for that.
Any other questions? Thank you very much for that. Well, item 9.
Thanks, Chair. Thank you. I think as far as I'm going to report, I've just been hearing from colleagues who have been from the Council as our external law arrangements. And I'd like to acknowledge and thank Robin for his congratulations regarding the most improved capital. It was actually predicated on the improved governance of the agency. We see evidence of that here this evening in terms of the challenge for members to offices and council reports, in terms of the improved risk management process. And of course, here what we have is hopefully a further upstream proposal that we've been moving on from where we were 2 years ago in having a random government statement to really set out in front of you for what we're looking for. It is clarity of purpose and making sure that you're satisfied that our approach to going to include the statements in 14-15 market is just there for you to see. So, quite clearly, the annual government statement will be probably the most important. Elements of the work that we will take here in this committee. And it's important to note that this is not about single elements of the organisation, this is the Council's annual governance statement, and quite clear from that perspective. Whilst internal audit, particularly external audit, do provide ample support, this is a whole Council approach, and I think that's an important facet of this, and therefore it's led by myself through the strategic leadership team. Having been signed off by the lead and the chief executive, which follows good practice. So it is about reviewing the adequacy of it and effectiveness of the key corporate governance controls, that's some which have been referred to this evening. Clearly, from an internal audit aspect and external audit, it's not about the same, it's about providing the evidence as well, and that would be robust evidence and sustainable. And clearly, from that perspective as well, it's also about providing the assurance. So each of the strategic directors, each of their chief officers and each of their charges had to provide a governance assurance statement that what they had in place actually stacks up. So we referred to before about the ownership and accountability of these aspects by being to the water trail all the way through it. So hopefully we'll be able to have an even stronger annual governance statement this year to identify that. Clearly what we refer to in the future is that in 5th of June, first cycle, the new municipal year, we'll have a draft and a good statement for the committee to consider. That would be our challenge then to then tie in with the reports that Rob and Chris and team colleagues have said around the September time when we'll get our final committee statement and closure of accounts information. Paragraph 4 sets out the significant governance issues that were identified in 2013-14. And we did say that we would bring to you regular updates on the performance and progress of these, and these are attached as the appendix. I won't propose to go through them specifically, we won't have to take any questions on them, and close the chair.
Well,
thank you.
Recommendations.
get on, identifying any items of note that I feel are appropriate to be yes with yourself, either for your attention or for action point. Provide performance data relating to the actual service, the general service, and identify any developments that we've been undertaking to help improve the way we've got to do the service. Your attention specifically drawn to section 2.2, page 1 of the report, where there are a number of items that I've noted that I feel worthy of your attention. 2.2a, piece of work that was undertaken on the scrutiny arrangements across the council, identified a very positive position in this important area of governance for effective member involvement, for well-evidence review from the same and or appropriate lines of monitoring procedures in place for the reviews that we have to examine. So it's a sort of a new story, it's something that we felt, again, say we bring you a lot of sort of bad news, but we felt it was appropriate to sort of try to balance that somewhat with something that might make you smile. We move on to 2.2b, risk management. This was a piece of work that was undertaken following up on a strategic piece of work that was undertaken down in the year. And this is this piece of work involved us sort of drilling down within departments, looking at compliance with corporate policy procedure, making sure that sort of there was a consistent sort of application of the risk management strategy and policy, and that there was also full compliance across the various department layers. Well, many areas of good practice identified, the overall opinion was that there was a moderate risk to the organisation if the risks that were identified during the course of that audit was materialised. We did make 10 recommendations in relation to suggested improvements in the corporate system and how this could be implemented more effectively across the various directorates. Very much supported the work that had been undertaken by Michael Ainley, the construction manager, and certainly admitted to some degree some of the findings from the benchmarking exercise that Tom Williams was a bit earlier. There is a synergy, there is a consistency across those sort of messages on it, and you will note from the early item on the agenda the policy itself was included within it. A lot of those issues have, you know, sort of, you'll see evidence to be addressed through that sort of policy. Further work is scheduled for 2015-16, and we'll continue to evaluate progress and we'll continue to bring reports back to yourselves, identifying sort of the status updates for you. 2.2c, piece of work is undertaken with the Better Care Fund. This is a government scheme that's due for implementation by April 2015 this year. It's a significant scheme, like I know, with some quite sort of wide-ranging implications and some quite sort of serious implications if don't get it right, we don't comply with this. The objective of the audit was basically to sort of provide sort of senior management with the assurances that they required regarding the arrangements that were put in place for the implementation, making sure they were robust, concentrated on the key risks to the organisation. The report did acknowledge that a significant amount of work has been undertaken within the development departments to determine the detailed operating arrangements that need to be utilised. The opinion provided was that there's a sort of moderate risk to the organisation if that we identified during the course of the audit to materialise. Management's attention was specifically drawn, formally drawn to a number of areas that required completion prior to full implementation. Management totally accept and agree with those sort of findings and are taking the necessary steps to ensure that there's a timetable in place, an action plan in place to address those by the April 2015 deadline. We will continue to work with the offices and departments. We will continue again to bring back to yourselves updates, bearing in mind that we're very close to that sort of April 2015 deadline, as we speak. I've no major concerns at the moment that we won't meet that deadline. However, I'll say I'm well certainly pretty frightened with the updates that you require. I'm conscious of that, that some of you might not get those updates formally until the June committee, but there are a number of sort of monthly reports that I'll be sending out to yourself. I'll put them on schedule for next week. And the following month, I'll be contained within it sort of more detail regarding sort of the position in relation to this initiative. If I can move on to 2.2d, which is a relates to the data loss prevention. This was a, you might recall, an item that we discussed at the previous meeting. A couple of the members asked for further information relating to data loss prevention and specifically security incidents across the council. By way of an explanation, I think it's worthy of being explained. Data loss prevention is actually a specific term for a strategy for making sure that end users don't send sensitive or critical information outside of the sort of corporate network. That's the easiest behind it all. Now, there's an awful lot of work being done by the Information Governance Board, chaired by the Strategic Director to my left, overseeing a lot of work in this area of operations to develop robust policy strategy that complies with best practice. We have had issues in the past with regards to the robustness of those controls. So the Information Governance Board has a fancy agenda, it has a very detailed action plan to identify specific risks and actions that needed be undertaken to address those risks. We, as an internal audit, do have a seat on that board and do feed into those discussions, those deliberations, those developments, action plans and plans. So we're on top of what's going on, so we're fully aware of any potential issues that may arise or any problems that are being encountered. And again, we'll have to bring those issues to yourself, sure, if it's appropriate. The work that's being done by the board at the moment involves a lot of work with information asset owners from within individual directors and departments to identify specifically where the risks and the threats exist and then developing action plans with those information asset owners to address quite specific those risks with as I say, quite detailed action with timescales and so on and so forth. I'm sort of happy with the progress that's been made and happy with any issues that do get sort of brought to the attention of the Information Governance Board. It doesn't just begin and end there, like there's a direct link to the senior leadership teams or things, or any issues that are where they also best placed, and then they do get to sort of keep the plan so they can develop both through their colleagues. Moving on to the security incidents themselves, again, I think I'm sort of providing a little bit of explanation about what we mean by a security incident. This is actually an event that may compromise the confidentiality, availability, or integrity of any council information. This could include the loss or damage to any ICT equipment that sort of stores or processes that data. It could be the disclosure of that information to someone authorised not to see it. The actual information policy for the council requires all staff to report these possible information security incidents so that investigations can be undertaken and any remedial actions or sort of taken to prevent a recurrence of those kind of incidents. Many reported incidents are regarded as what we call sort of near miss. When incident was reported, but there's no sort of actual evidence of any loss or compromising of the data that was held. It might be that a lost asset was recovered like an airline to one balance line, but there wasn't any sort of immediate direct impact of that. The Information Governance Board again has a significant role to play with regards to this kind of this issue. And does oversee and monitor all of the information governance and security activity. It gets reported to all of those incidents, all of those near misses, so they can be analysed, discussed, debated, and appropriate actions taken again. 2014, there were no formal referrals to the Information Commission. I think that was a direct question asked by one of the members. There were no formal referrals made to the Information Commission. However, there were a number of reported security incidents and near misses that were dealt with by the council and appropriate actions taken to prevent the occurrence of those type of incidents. The incidents relate to the likes of, I've sort of categorised them, I've picked the sort of top three or four type of incidents that we encountered. Emails, incorrect recipients, suspicious emails being received from external bodies trying to sort of attempt to defraud the council applicants and the like. Loss of physical devices such as encrypted USB sticks and the like. Printing where information is not collected promptly from printers that are located in various places around the organisation. Sounds fairly innocuous, but again, the potential for quite significant problems to arise is a great one. So they're the top sort of three that I've identified. Again, I make reference to the Information Governance Board and its role in this, like, it's an important role, and the good work that's being done, and the fact that we're involved in this. Gives me the confidence that we are sort of on top of this sort of issue and that we are taking the right steps to develop the right procedures and policies. And again, I continue to sort of come back to yourselves with anything that I feel is a serious problem. Do you want me to finish or do you want to jump in now, Councillor? Attention is also drawn to section 2.3 of the report. There's a table identifying information related to those audits where recommended actions included in our audit reports have not currently been implemented. As been discussed previously, the
means is that might be that the sort of the actual actions sit within the agreed time to that hasn't yet been met. The table is attached to Appendix 1. What I will say is that whilst all the recommendations of the company made for the down button indicating that there's sort of way for progress within the time phase to address the issues that we've talked about, quite a number of those have now turned to green since the report was produced. You'll note from the report that there are quite a number of items there that, that have dates on that indicate that we're being able to take follow-up work from the same buyers back in January, during the course of February, and as recently as early sort of March. So what I've done is I've collated that information today and, just to give you a flavour for sort of, you know, how many of those amber rated sort of flat bags and flat have now turned to green and we'll look at that report. Of the January flat follow-up work pieces, there were five identified on that report, and four of those are now rated green, indicating that we're full implementation of the recommendations. There's one I'm reading on that that's still on there, that relates to a specific issue regarding training that's been rolled out across the organization. So once it's now agreed on, the action has been taken, which is the question of once we get the sort of final report, like say we've now completed all of that sort of training, we can sign off on that. For the February report, all of those items are now rated green and drop off. And then for the March dated sort of audits, six of the 11 audits that were identified on the report now turned to green. The remainder is the work that's currently ongoing as we speak. I've literally got people sort of undertaking follow-ups for those and will be completed by the end of this month. What I will do is I'll be able to provide you with a little bit more detail in terms of the work that's undertaken and the findings to support the green flag via a bi-monthly report which is scheduled to go to yourselves directly next week. The other one by email so you can look, which gives you a bit more detail about some of the audit and the opinions and sort of the detailed recommendations. So I'll say that was signed up by SLT on Tuesday this week, so I'll be sending that either back end this week or the next week. Moving on then, section 2.4, identify information related to the performance of the internal service. You'll note this around time, I'm happy with the delivery of your plan. See the reason why we won't be in a position to come the end of this month, but I'll be happy to deliver that into that. There may be a little bit of work that sort of carries over into the new year, and there's a continuity arrangement within the plan going forward to take account of that. You know, we don't just sort it off. Margins come all the way, that there's this way that's in progress, it's clearly much better, but it's unavoidable. And finally, in section 2.5, as I always do, I'll show up some of the continued improvements that we make in the service, and ensure that we continue to comply with best practice and constantly sort of be evaluating and moving forward in how we go on to do the service. As much as I want to say, I've probably said too much, but I'm more than happy to take any questions about you may have.
Counteracting fraud within local government, it's significant. train, held on with continuous improvement, along with looking at the good practice elsewhere. While we are the most improved council we want to be the best council that we're going forward, so we've had a part of getting our return stuff right. For them to put a confidence outward face to organisations that they are actually tackling it. I would think great credit goes to Martin and his team for the way they've done, and that's why I want to actually change things around a lot to what they've been doing in the past. And for that fact, I'd just like to add a 13.4 to the recommendation. And I have to thank Eric and Terry for the work they've done for the Audit Committee Commission Committee. 2014-15.
Does that agree with the chair?
Agree?
Yeah. Agree. Yeah. That's
John?
It's on towards the end of 2.2.2. And it says email will be incorrect instructions and then suspicious emails received by council staff. You included that the suspicious emails for the same words as well. The reason I ask is that certainly I was in a physical cash 22 situation. There was a time when it fell into two categories. One, they received a bulk thing, but because the pressure worker couldn't send it out until after 6 o'clock last Friday. And but the other, you know, this is suspicious, you know, get in touch. And now what it said is on 2 or 3 recently had impact is that we think there's something suspicious about these. We think you, unless we hear from you in 30 days, or you know, we'll destroy something. What used to happen is they would give a name or some address of where it's come from. So that way I could make sure I wasn't getting an explanation to met by the Marcus of Saul or something like that. And that's fine. But really, it says, if you feel, I think we're going to ask if you have some an idea of what it is, you know, let us know. I thought, so, since there's no information, there's no information. And then we're going to find out later on, it might be too late because you've destroyed it after 30 days. Isn't it possible to get some little clue in as to what it's about? Because that, I'm sure that I would say that, and I just did.
So in order, if we consider an important issue, and it's flagged up as a minimum control environment with major organisational impact, that if we are going to continue to monitor it in some way, that we would be, if you like, figures against the category in some way. So that next year when we receive it, or maybe a couple of meetings on, we can see whether, for example, if printing is a category, you know, the stuff left on a printer, because it's maybe a near miss, or I printed it off and it wasn't there, and you put in place a controlling measure, then presumably we will see for one period, one quarter, say, that there were 7 incidents that we put in place a control measure, and it hasn't happened again. It strikes me that we have no control over people emailing us with suspicious scripts or whatever it is, or random viruses, but we have control over emails that we might send arriving to people who never intended to send them to. Notwithstanding the dreaded replies and long mistake that people have done, everybody's waited some point all the way to the plastic computer, and only start to type something in, somebody else ends up with the number of stewards there are. And the number of times I've had Phil Gilchrist's street scene fails, for example. Because he starts ST and then he clicks gone, and he says, there's a street name missing, and I said, I'll be on 3 in the morning. And but clearly there can be more serious incidents. If we know how many there are, we know what the control measures you plan to put in place are, and we can then make judgments as to whether they're working on us. But when I read the minutes, I thought it was an accurate description. We were looking forward to data. Instead, we got a sentence that said, yeah, it's been a couple. But we're not telling you how many that is.
Let me tell you now, Councillor. I was in 2 minds as to how much detail to actually go into. I'll be honest with you there. It's quite a word in the ball. There's a lot of detail in there, so I think I wasn't too sure quite how much you would require from me. I'll try and keep it short and sweet now, rather than burden you with an awful analysis of the board and come on with some kind of things. I have got a question of these incidents are logged and recorded and analysed on a monthly basis. I've got a question which actually breaks down the number of incidents for the last 12 months. There were 46 incidents in total, so we're not talking about thousands, it's a reasonable number. If you look at the pie chart, emails are by far and away the biggest issue. There were 10 instances involving emails over that period. The second largest is the loss of, as I mentioned before, sort of devices, be they USB printer devices or whatever. And the third item is the printing issue. We then drop to 4 instances of disclosure, and then we get into the realms of 2 to 1s on access controls, authorised use of software, sort of pay phone scams, so relatively minor numbers, so they learn that. I'll happily provide them with that sort of information if that's what you require. So I said I wanted to provide you with the assurance that the matters are being monitored correctly, they are being analysed in the right way, actions are being taken to address the issues that were there, rather than be sort of overloading with a lot of very detailed information without getting to the sort of you want the assurances from us, from the officers, and it is you that these things are interesting. They are, trust me, they are. But I'm more happy to tell you
that. So, in terms of the 46, that's data, say, from the year 2014.
It is.
So, do we hold the data for 2013? It's more than comparison.
I'm pretty sure we do, yeah. I mean, I couldn't say hand and heart, but I'm pretty sure we do. The systems and the knowledge have been in place for some time. I'd be very surprised. We've said, and you might better be aware, but I'm pretty certain we do. I said look into that, and we can make those kind of delicate.
It might be as easy to say, but by the time you get something, this time next year, then the comparison will be 15 to 14. That would probably be a more useful one if a lot of the controls are going to be based on the systems that we've got, rather than just continuing on back. So we know that we have 46 across a range of headings. Now the trick will be, one of us, next year, we would expect some of those controls to ensure that the 46 is well has fallen. That's the evidence, if you like, that shows you where it is.
What I would say is that the dating on the back won't be as good as the data going forward, because as a quite pointed out earlier, we have formal information coming as board, and we have time to see if we've got policies in place that we didn't have years back. So the data will be more readily available and be in a more detailed sort of format going forward, like we can see the 2014 data, whether the 2013 data go into this level of detail.
If staff in 2013 didn't have quite so many tablets or have, they would be rolled out to improve service delivery, make savings, etc. We might actually have lower figures, but what actually tells us, I think 14-15 will probably be the more like for like comparison.
I think Mark's just from the information from this book, and they certainly something we're wrestling with is how you measure things, right? Because having had some experience in other authorities, actually one thing positive from this that would be quite interesting, 46 question for that's actually for staff coming forward and telling us that they've done them as a preventative measure as opposed to being discovered as a consequence of seeing it in somewhere else. That's good news. I think also as well in terms of maybe we see a spike in terms of numbers of reporting from staff because they feel confident the culture's changed. Because if I've made a mistake, if I've printed something off and I shouldn't have done it, because I'm on printer, I'm okay saying I've done it. I think it's about also as well, like the controls putting in about having those data lockdowns that we do in terms of having the printers that are locked. So actually I can't print it off on that printer over there because I have to go through my numbering and therefore nobody else can pick it up. So again, so it's going to be fluctuations as we move through with those better governance management facilities. And I think that the one that I think everybody wants to think about, all of the high profile losses, on London Underground, everything else in terms of laptops or actually the forms that people have, because as the forms got smaller and smaller and smaller and they're in your pocket, it was the encryption that was the first one. So actually, I'm not obviously alarmed if somebody loses a data block. Actually, I'm less alarmed because all our data blocks are encrypted. So in terms of getting the numbers, it's still about improvement. But I agree with you, if we can get to some kind of measures that actually demonstrate progress in Syria, we'll do that. But I suspect we'll be also having a similar discussion next year about how we've still got 46, but we've got 46 different variants, and so just be sure to be successful.
I just want to go to the last page of the appendix where it's got the IT disaster recovery again. It's just the outcome. Given that it's a major organisational impact, and the reason why it's not being carried out is due to the plans of upgrade systems, surely producing the disaster recovery plan is a question of priorities of whether everyone can upgrade or their computer to take precedence over the whole council's disaster recovery plan. So why?
Something that has been escalated, so again, there's a phenomenal amount of work being done across the organisation in relation to business continuity, to say in all its sort of different forms, and this is extending wider. The new head of IT has clearly recognised that, like a normal environment, and has certainly sort of moved it up his list of priorities, and it is something that's been worked on at the moment. I'm aware of that because I remember staff like who specialise in ICT audits, so they've been working with colleagues in ICT. So whilst that may have been the decision at the time of the audit plan, and things have moved on somewhat, I'll reflect that in the monthly update report that I alluded to earlier you get this week. So I'll put some more out in there to fuse that.
Monitor in this case.
whilst the the areas of improvement were identified within the report, there is also an action plan that identifies them in some specific detail. There's also target deadlines against those. So once the recommendations, such there were areas for management to focus upon and to ensure that they comply with. So we will be doing the monitoring, we will undertake some sort of further work with senior management within those departments to make sure that they are on target to achieve. And again, report back to yourselves if there's any suggestions at all that would be the case.
Yeah, that's what I'm asking. Yeah. It's raised the issue, and it's got a time scale. The other reports and entries and the entries are in action, or they are in the process of action.
I will happily bring you back a report, certainly at the next meeting. It might be that at that time, you might want an update from one of the officers responsible for that initiative. So I'll have a talk to colleagues from across the department and find out and get somebody along to talk you through some of what was done and provide you with those kind of additional assurances that I won't be able to provide you.
That's great.
Thank you.
You know,
yeah.
It's not so much about the risk, it's the reputation.
Yeah. Certainly the opinion provided on them being a sort of more risk was in relation to those areas not being addressed well enough. I did mention in the report that there's a significant amount of work being done elsewhere, so I don't think there's any danger of not complying with the legislation. There are just elements of that which we need to just tighten things up on my own, just to ensure that we get that deadline. And that's why it's only a sort of more risk. If there was any risk whatsoever of us not achieving that deadline in totality, then that would be a significantly higher risk. And we'd probably have the office of responsible citizens just now really ask you questions and provide you with answers.
Any other questions?
Yeah.
Any other questions?
Yeah.
Any other questions? Can you read the recommendations on
it? We do just make that in.
We just have a look at that.
Yeah.
What you have before you is the internal plan of work for the council's internal audit service for 2015-16. The plan is effectively the final year of a three-year strategic plan. You may recall that we yourself signed off on back in 2013. The plan contains an explanation of how it was prepared and identifies a list of the proposed areas to be audited for 2015-16. I suppose the main points to note are that the service operates on a three-year strategic cyclical planning cycle. The rationale here being to ensure that the terminal takes a wider and more strategic view of the risks and ensures that work effort is utilised efficiently and as effectively as possible to try and mitigate risks in those areas. That said, the annual plan clearly needs to be extremely flexible, needs to be dynamic. The organisation is going through such sort of fundamental changes, like in terms of how services are delivered. Like we need to be able to respond and react to that. So the plan is designed in such a way to accommodate those changes, and you all are party to those changes. I bring to your attention sort of changes that I want to make to the plan throughout the course of the year. So I sit down on a regular sort of monthly, if not sort of quarterly, monthly basis with senior officers, and we talk about sort of risks that emerge and things that need to change to the plan. So you'll notice from the plan there are a number of sort of themes in there rather than very detailed specific audits, and that does allow us again an element of flexibility to determine where the risks are greatest within those themed areas and what we need to do to provide senior management yourselves with the assurances that are required. The